the Lutheran Church of the Holy Spirit worship online, and thank you for continuing to make this a part of your spiritual journey. If you find this weekly worship encouraging and helpful, I'd like to also invite you to take a moment to share a link with your friends, to like, or subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks again for being here. We're just a couple of weeks from Holy Week, and just a reminder that if you are in the Denver metro area, you are invited to participate with our Holy Week services. Monday, Thursday is April 6th at 7 o'clock, and Good Friday services are April 7th at 7 o'clock, and then that is followed by Easter celebration that Sunday, the 9th of April at 9 o'clock. Now I invite you to light a candle in your space as a visible symbol and a reminder of the Holy Spirit's presence and partnership in our lives and in our work in the world. In today's gospel, Jesus reveals his power over death by raising Lazarus from the dead. The prophet Ezekiel prophesies God breathing new life into dry bones. To those in exile or living in the shadows of death, these stories proclaim God's promise of resurrection. In baptism, we die with Christ that we might also be raised with him to new life. And at the Easter Vigil, we will welcome the newly baptized as we remember God's unfailing promise in our baptism. God of impossibilities, you choose to enter human flesh through the one who called herself lowly. Teach us, who daily receive announcements of Christ's coming, to live as Mary did, trusting in your power to bring your desire to fulfillment. Amen. Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading for this service comes from Ezekiel, the 37th chapter. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were all dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' Thus says the Lord God to these bones, 'I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and you will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them. The flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breathe, and breath upon, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Out of the depths
I cry to you, O Lord.
O Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication.
If you were to keep watch over sin,
O Lord, who could stand?
Yet with you is forgiveness.
In order that you may be feared,
I wait for you, O Lord, my soul waits.
In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning.
More than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love.
With the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
For the Lord shall redeem Israel
from all their sins.
Our gospel reading comes from the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sister sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." And the disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" And Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to the fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." And then Jesus arrived, and when Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." And Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." And when she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were there with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. And when Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and the stone was lying against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there's a stench because he's been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary had seen what Jesus did, and they believed in him. The Gospel of our Lord. Have you ever wondered? No one asks Lazarus if he wants to be resurrected. Now that's this fascinating part about our gospel story today. No one asks Lazarus if Lazarus wants to return to this broken and hurting body, these tangled relationships, and the responsibilities of his finances and his job and his family. He was a good man. There's no doubt that he had a direct path. Do not pass, go straight to the bliss of union with God. What a terrifying and awful feeling to be yanked back down to earth with such suddenness. You can read stories of folks who have near-death experiences, who return to life with this new sense of purpose, with this joy and awe at the knowledge that there truly is something in the beyond, and that it is beautiful and it is loving. But for everyone who returns with joy and purpose, there is also someone else who returns with a profound sense of despair and rejection. "I saw God," they say. "I saw God and I felt God's love and I experienced this unbelievable peace and God threw me back. God didn't want me. God saw fit to return me to this petty human life in this small, limited human body. How could God do that?" Well, which group was Lazarus in? Was his reaction thanksgiving or disappointment? We don't know, because Lazarus never speaks in the Gospels. It could be that with Mary and Martha around, his words were of little importance. But nobody asks Lazarus if he wants to be resurrected. And nobody asks us. Lazarus was Jesus' friend. And it turns out resurrection is the price of friendship with Jesus. Have you ever thought about it that way? Resurrection is the price of friendship with Jesus. Now, resurrection is scary because the price of resurrection seems to be responsibility. Once we've been brought back to life by Jesus, we have this mission to accomplish. We are compelled by the miracle to share with others the truth that they too can experience this radical rebirth. We strive, even knowing that it's all a free gift of God's grace, to act in some way that honors Jesus and then builds up the kingdom. We seek to honor the gift of honoring the giver. And we honor the giver by honoring God's presence in one another. Easy. Easy, pretty words for a very difficult task. It really would have been easier and much nicer just simply to stay dead. Dead. We're in this eternal joy with God. Resurrected. We have to begin the journey anew, this journey of loving, of failing, of forgiving, of trusting, of the whole mess of joy and pain that this human spiritual life is. The other question that tugs at the heartstrings for many people who read this text is, why did Jesus let Lazarus die in the first place? It's the same question that the disciples and the townspeople are asking themselves throughout this gospel. It's the same question that Mary and Martha ask him directly when they see him. Martha running out to demand why his love wasn't strong enough to come when they called him. Mary hiding away because she fears her anger will overwhelm her and she's going to lash out at Jesus. They both make the same exact accusation. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." How many times have we asked the same question? Sometimes in rage, sometimes in sadness, sometimes in confusion, sometimes in despair. "Lord, if you had been here, my child would not have died. Lord, if you had been here, my ability to pay my bills would not have died. Lord, if you had been here, my church would not have died. Lord, if you had been here, my marriage would not have died. Lord, if you had been here, my sobriety would not have died. Lord, if you had been here, my faith would not have died." What a painful truth it is to discover that Jesus is not going to ride to the rescue in shining armor on this white horse. Mary and Martha, they discovered it. Lazarus, he discovered it. The disciples, they've discovered it. Jesus will not save us from the cross because he will not save himself from the cross. And he will not save us from the cross because Straight through the cross is the path to new life, this resurrection. It's no easier for him than it is for us. Jesus weeps in this gospel. He's a respected spiritual teacher in the community, and on top of that, he's the Son of God, and he loses his composure completely. The pain that he feels as he witnesses some of the people he's closest to sudden question the truth and their trust and their love for him, question their belief in him. They look at him with disappointment and anger in their eyes because they believe that he's failed them. It hurts. But he will not spare himself this pain, nor will he spare Mary, Martha, and Lazarus their pain. This pain leads to resurrection, and Jesus is with them, never abandoning them. And so it is for us. We have 1 week left to decide if we're going to Jerusalem with Jesus or not. We have plenty of time to back up. Next week, it's Palm Sunday. And very soon, the joy of walking with Jesus and seeing him heal and feed and teach so many people, the joy of experiencing him heal and feed and teach us, will start to have this very steep price. Suddenly we're being asked to go somewhere very dark and scary, a place where the authorities are crashing down on all sides and where once loving crowds turned against us and him, where we discover to our bewilderment that we're shouting for his crucifixion along with the crowd. He will be arrested. He will be tried. He will be convicted. And he will be executed. And we have a choice whether or not we will witness this. The first disciples, they split right down the middle on this choice. Most of them actually ran away. A few of them stuck it out all the way to the foot of the cross and then laid him in the tomb. Most of the ones who talked the biggest, they ran the fastest. Jesus loves them anyway. We can run too. We can skip straight from Palm Sunday to Easter celebration, figuring, well, it's all going to work out in the end. Why put myself through all that depressing crucifixion stuff and the terrible long week leading up to it? Jesus is going to love us anyway. And he will. He absolutely will. And we will never taste the fullness of the resurrection until we go to the cross with this Jesus. We can stay safe. We can even stay dead. We can keep our eyes closed and our hearts no longer beating and our bones and spirits as dried up and motionless as the dry bones in Ezekiel's valley. It will be peaceful, even though a little more empty. Or we can go with him. We can pray, read scripture, live in community every day of Holy Week, walking with Jesus in real time through the last week of his life, bolstering our courage by sticking together and refusing to give up no matter how hard it gets. We can face the truth that we can be rescued from pain or we can be resurrected to new life, but we cannot have both. Jesus accepting Lazarus' death and then calling him back to life, it was a gift to Mary and Martha and Lazarus and the disciples, and it's a gift to us. He's about to go through the same process, although with much, much higher stakes and a great deal more pain. But he lets us see what will happen ahead of time when we're open to the journey. He shows us that, first of all, there is life on the other side of death, and second, that there is truth, not just for the Son of God, but for regular people, for the friends of Jesus, and that is us. The first thing he says when Lazarus walks out of the tomb, Unbind him and let him go. He says the same thing to us. Unbind them. We can be unbound. Unbound from our fear, unbound from our lies, unbound from our grief. No one asks Lazarus if he wants to die. And no one asks him if he wants to be resurrected. Each is the price of the other. No one asks us. No one asks us if we want to be resurrected either. And yet the question remains. On the other side of that question are freedom and life abundant. And to that we say, thanks be to God. Church, the world, and all of creation. You have breathed into us the breath of life. Enliven your church, deepen our partnerships with other companion churches around the globe, and bless the work of missionaries who accompany them. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Your Spirit brings life to creation. Enliven the natural world and restore ecosystems in need of healing. Uplift prophetic voices that turn us to the needs of the soil beneath our feet and the air all around us. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You redeem the world and its peoples. Free us from systems of oppression. Unbind nations and societies from the sins of racism, sexism, and homophobia. Raise up leaders at all levels of government to work to promote the dignity of every human life. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You weep when we weep. Be present with those who grieve or who are troubled by illness. You hear us when we call to you. Deliver us from the depths of our despair and free us from the worries that bind us. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Your Spirit of life dwells in our assembly. Bless the music ministries of this congregation and bless all who lead us in hymns of praise and thanksgiving and in the songs of lament and prayer. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Today we pray for Kelly W., Ron, Nettie, Kelly M., all that we name now with our lips and in our hearts. merciful God, receive our prayer. You are the resurrection and the life. Even though we die, we will live. With thanksgiving, we remember all your saints who now live in your eternal love. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now receive this blessing. May God, the giver of love, may Christ, the resurrection and the life, and may the Holy Spirit of rebirth bless you in this Lenten journey. Amen. Go in peace. Serve in love. Thanks be to God.